So we have done some algebra, a preparatory work before studying the homology of topological spaces. We shall do one more algebraic preparation, though it is not necessary immediately. Okay, this fits into the kind of preparation that we are making. Strangely, this is the title of this talk is about Euler characteristic, which is very much topological. But here we are going to give it a completely algebraic treatment. The Euler characteristic will be discussed again and again in this course. So we are only initiating a discussion now. So here is a definition. Take the category of R modules where R is a commutative ring, preferably a PID. And if you have difficulty, as I have told you right in the beginning, you can just then R is the ring of integers and modules are just abelian groups. No problem. An additive function on this category, we mean an integral integer value set function L on the isomorphism classes of R modules. The set of R, the collection of all R modules is not a set, but isomorphism classes of R modules is a set by axiom of choice, whatever. So on that set, you take a set pretty function, which takes values in the actually non-negative integers. It should have the following property. What is the property? Whenever you have a short exact sequence of R modules, M prime, M and M double prime, okay, you should have the L of M, L is the function, okay, this L is a function. L of M must be equal to L of M prime plus L of M double prime. Okay, so you can call it a length function, which happens to be studied in algebra at various levels. What I want to say is, by simple induction, any additive function will have this property. Namely, whenever you have a finite sequence, not necessarily short exact sequence, a finite short exact sequence, M1, M2, Mn to 0, this is exact sequence. Then the alternate sum of L of Mi's, the L of Mi, I have taken L of M1 minus sign, next one plus sign, minus sign, plus sign, and so on. Minus 1 raised to I, I am taking alternate sum, that is always 0. So this could have been here written in that form, namely L of M prime on this side minus plus L of M, which is the second term, which is with a plus sign, again minus L of M double prime, which is third term. Is zero. Okay. So there is no other way of writing this one either in the general case. That's the correct way to write down this additivity. So additive functions, I have this property on general things. Summation, alternate summation is zero. Okay. So how to prove this one? I have told you that long exact sequences like this can be always split up into short exact sequences, and then whatever short exact sequence you know, you can use that inductively. So here is a chance for that to illustrate that principle. So let us name this map, the first map M1 to M2 as alpha 1, just for the sake of it, okay? So now I have M1 to M2 to M3, etc. I don't care what they are. This is the first one is alpha 1. So what I do, I'll split up this one. I don't go directly to M3, but I go to M2 modulo image of alpha 1. So there's a co-kernel of alpha 1, right? So this map is surjective. So if you look at the 0 to M1 to M2 to M2 by M3 to 0, this is a short exact sequence. Okay, therefore L of this plus L of minus L of this plus L of this plus L of that minus L of this is 0. Right? So I know this much. Now I want to go here, M2 by image of alpha 1, this map, whatever this map is, on image of alpha 1, it is 0. Therefore, it factors down to M2 by alpha and gives you this map here. And that map, because this sequence is, suppose this is alpha 2 now, just for sake. Then kernel of alpha 2 is precisely equal to alpha 1. I am killing the kernel of alpha 1, which is image of alpha 1. Therefore, it becomes injective. Okay, this means that at this point, it is exact. From here onward, the image of this alpha 2 is the same thing as image of this alpha 2 bar, whatever. Beyond that, I haven't changed. Okay, now look at the length of this sequence. It has come down by 1. Okay, so this you can call it as M2. M1 is absent. Now 0 to M2 to M3 and so on. So apply induction on this one. The alternate sum of this one will be 0. Now add this one. What you get is precisely the statement of this theorem. Alternate sum of this one. Okay, so this term cancels out. The extra term that you have got is, when you take alternate sum, it will cancel out. Okay, so an additive function has this property. Whenever you have finitely many terms and exact sequence, then the alternate sum is 0. Okay, so this should be a very good measure to measure the deviation of a chain complex from being an exact sequence. You see, at least in the case when you have only finitely many terms to deal with. So we go towards that, namely, on the category of finitely generated R modules over a ring R, that R must be a principal ideal domain, then there is a structure theorem, just like in the case of abelian groups, finitely generated abelian groups, modules over the integers. Okay, every module, finite generated module, can be written as direct sum of its torsion module, which corresponds to elements of finite order, direct sum with a free module, which is of finite rank. Okay, so for every finitely generated R module over a ring, the rank function is one of the most important functions, and that function is additive function. Direct sum of two modules, when you take the rank, it will be the sum of these two. That's why it's called additive. From that, you can produce a little more. Namely, if you have short exact sequence of R modules, okay, over a PID, the rank will be such that alternate sum of the ranks is 0. A simplest case is when R is a field. Then what are finitely generated modules over a field? They are vector spaces. So if you have short exact sequence of vector spaces, the M1 to M2 to M3, the rank nullity theorem is nothing but the dimensions are additive functions. Namely, alternate sum of them is zero. So this is a very nice name. This is called rank nullity theorem. Rank of a linear map is the image of the dimension of the image. And nullity is the dimension of the kernel. So this is precisely what it is. If you have three terms, if you take this map alpha here, M double prime is the image of alpha, and M prime is the kernel. So if you put L as the dimension of these things, then L of M is something L of M prime plus L of M. That's a rank nullity theorem. The same thing as dimension is an additive function. Okay. So this dimension is called rank in the case of arbitrary rings. For arbitrary rings or commutative rings, this is a difficult notion. Sometimes the rank may not be defined properly. Okay. In general, it is not defined. All right. But for a PID, it's well defined. There are other cases also where it is defined. Not necessarily PID, but we don't want to get into that kind of algebra here. Okay. So let L be an additive function on some category F of R modules. A chain complex C dot of R module is said to be finite type. Finite type means what? For a chain complex, finite type with respect to L. L is fixed. If all CNs are objects in this F, okay, even some subcategory of R modules I have taken, and L of CN must be zero for almost all N. That means only finitely many terms are non-zero. So I am cooking up this one because I want to take alternate sum. If it's infinite sum, it won't make sense. Okay, they are integers. There is no question of convergence. Convergence means that after finite stage, it must be zero. Okay, so that is what I have put in this condition. L of Cn must be zero for almost all means what? Finitely many. Except for finitely many, it must be zero. In that case, alternate sum is defined. That is the whole idea. Okay, so such a C will be called finite type with respect to L. If you change L, this may not be finite type. Okay, the given C may not be finite type with respect to one L, and with respect to some other L, some other additive function, it may be. So there are such cases also. You have to be careful about that. So what is of very prime importance for us is, if R is a PID, and L is the rank function. Okay, this is the same as saying that all CNs are of finite rank and most of them have rank equal to zero. Because I am taking L as a rank function now. We then merely refer to C dot as finite type. When you say it is finite type, we are interested in R as a PID and L is the rank function. In particular, R could be integers, and this R is what? The rank. L is rank. Then we don't say rank with respect, finite type with respect to what and so on. Finite type means finite type with respect to this. Otherwise, I have to mention what is this L. Okay? So this is just a convention. Thus, for example, when R is Z, a finite type chain complex of abelian groups need not be finite type with respect to some other additive function other than the rank function. we can give you other additive functions also. You can think about it. Now here is the theorem that we are interested in. Okay, what is this? The rank function defined for the chain complex now gives you something interesting on the homology. Okay, let C dot be a chain complex of R modules of finite type with respect to an additive function L. Then the alternate sum of Ln's for L of Cn's is alternate sum of L of Hn of Cn. Okay, the indexing must be carefully correctly chosen. Okay, you can't change the indexing, otherwise there will be a sign change here. If you change the index just shifting one by one or something, then the whole thing will change sign, right? So you have to be careful about it. So from the chain complex, from the homology you can go. If the chain complex is actually an exact one, then what happens here? Alternate sum would have been zero. So that would say that the alternate sum of all the homologies is zero, which is a very weak statement. You know that if Cn is exact, all the Hn's are zero. Therefore, L of Hn's will be also zero. An additive function will always take zero on the zero module. So that's easy to verify. Okay. So minus 1 power n summation will be zero. Each term will be zero. So this is a very weak thing, but it's very, very useful. Okay. It's a much weaker statement, but it's very, very useful. Okay, so here is a proof. Once again, splitting. You know, long thing, you know, whole Cn I have to do, but we will do it by splitting and then some kind of induction. Okay, for each n, we have the short exact sequence. Concentrate at Cn. Some function. Some operator comes here, some operator leaves here. Okay. So Cn2, Cn minus 1, I have daba n. Don't take the whole of Cn minus 1, but take just the image here. Then you get a surjective map. Okay. This Cn2 image of daba n, this map itself is daba n, and that is a surjective map. What is the kernel? Kernel of daba n. And that is an injective map. So you have a short exact sequence like this. Okay, therefore, L of Cn must be L of daba n plus L of image of daba n. L of kernel of daba n plus L of image of daba n. Okay, now, what have definition of Hn of C star? What is it? It is kernel of daba n divided by image of daba n plus 1. So you have an exact sequence there, namely image of daba n plus 1 to kernel of daba n, and then the quotient is Hn of Cn. Therefore, L of this middle thing is equal to L of this one plus L of this one. Right? Now substitute this in the left-hand side of the equation here for Hn. Hn are all this. Okay, then you can rewrite this, then you get this one. Alternatively, what you can do is, you can write this minus this plus this is zero. Minus this plus this minus this is zero, and then take the summation. Then here also take the summation. So minus 1 raised to n, L of image of daba n is equal to minus of minus 1 raised to n, L of image of daba n plus 1. So plus 1, okay, see, this plus 1, if you shift it through n, then this will be, this minus sign will come out, so you should cancel out. That's why these two are equal, right? That's all I have to say. The same terms I have shifted, so that's a minus sign. So use this, these two terms on the left hand, right hand side, they will cancel out. So what I have done, substitute for hn of this one by this thing, and then use this property. Okay, so additive functions from chain complex to homology, it works. Namely, there will be additive functions of homology also. So now we make a definition with this great observation. Okay, let R be a PID, M a graded module of finite type. I recall what is the meaning of this, namely, the most of them, okay, L of that, the rank of them are zero. Finitely many of them are there, and they are of rank finite. Okay, that is the meaning of finite type with respect to this one. This implies that the rank of Mn is finite for all n and zero except for finitely many n. Okay, that is the recalling what is the meaning of finite type. We define the Euler characteristic by the formula. This is the standard notation chi m. Okay, m is a graded module now, not just one single module. Chi m is I range from minus into plus infinity, but it's a finite sum. Okay, minus 1 raised to I, the rank of mi. Okay, this is special case, not now L is replaced by the rank function, rank of mi, where rank denotes the rank function. So this is called the Euler characteristic. You could have defined chi L also with respect to L. Then you take minus 1 raised to I, L of Im. So you can call that as a Euler characteristic with respect to L. But without any qualifier, Euler characteristic just means minus 1 to the I summation rank of Mi's. So you have this, whatever you have proved it, we have this one. Namely, if C is a finite type chain complex of R modules over a PID, then the Euler characteristic of the homology is equal to Euler characteristic of the chain complex itself. So this is the algebra that we needed later on. So we have established that one. The above theorem tells that the Euler characteristic of a finitely generated chain complex is the same as the Euler characteristic of its homology groups. In our context, R is either the ring of integers or a field. We could have taken R, C, Q, we do that kind of thing. Then all these things would be just the dimension of those vector spaces, which is the same thing as a rank of as a module. So it should not cause you any worry, even if you do not know what are PIDs and what are modules for PIDs. The notion of Euler characteristic plays a very important role in the development of algebraic topology, differential geometry, and etc. It manifests itself in a variety of ways, from the simple observation, namely number of vertices minus number of edges plus number of faces equal to 2. This is the so-called the famous formula of Euler for what? For a planar graph. Number of vertices minus number of edges plus the number of domains, faces, is equal to, always equal to 2. So this was the observation of Euler. So you can say Euler was the great grandfather of topology. But this simple thing has now become so great, you know, it manifests in so many other ways. There are at least half a dozen different definitions, and then you prove for okay, this is equal to that, that's equal to this, this is equal to that, that's equal to this, and so on at various places. And then you take one of them as generalize it and so on. So you get one Artiya-Singer index theorem for elliptic operators and all sort of things. Selberg trace formula, so many other things. They are all interrelated. So you take one aspect of it, generalize it and do something and so on. So this has created, just one single thing of Euler has created a lot of mathematics. So let us do one more slight variation of this one, if not all that Artiya-Singer and so on. So this is called left edge number. This will also be used in the SQL in this course. Okay, so we fixed ourselves with PID, R is a PID, M is finitely generated module over R. This tor M denotes the submodule of all torsion elements in M, namely R times X equal to 0 for some R non-zero. Then X is called torsion element. It is just like finite elements of finite order. N times X is 0. Means what? X is the finite order, right, in an abelian group. So that is generated, that such things are called torsion instead of finite elements. They are not finite, they are not called finite order, but torsion elements. So this tor M denotes the submodule of all torsion elements. The quotient module M by tor M is a free module of finite rank. So this is a non-trivial result, which is true for PIDs, okay, which is equal to the rank of M itself. The rank of M is the same thing as the rank of the free part. For any endomorphism from M to M, there is an induced endomorphism F bar from M by tor M to M by tor M, because the torsion element always goes to torsion element. So you can quotient out by that. So you get a morphism on a free module. If you fix a basis for a free module, means there is always a basis, right? A finite basis will be there now. If you fix a basis, then this linear endomorphism can be written in terms of a matrix. So if the rank is R, then it will be an R cross R matrix, okay? The trace of this F is defined to be the trace of the corresponding matrix for F bar. Okay, and one can verify that it is independent of the choice of the basis. This is elementary linear algebra. Okay, trace function of a matrix A, B, A inverse, trace of this, the same thing as trace of B. Because trace of AB equal to trace of BA, that's what you have verified. Okay, so same thing works here. The trace will be independent of what basis you choose. Okay, so we can define the trace of endomorphism F itself. All right, now we are in business. So now instead of M, we are looking at endomorphisms. Instead of the module, we are looking at endomorphisms. So what we do is a simple exercise here, okay, similar to what we have exact sequences, the additivity of the rank function. Rank of B was equal to rank of C plus rank of A, right? So we generalize this here, take a exact sequence here, and an endomorphism of the exact sequence. Okay, suppose this is a commutative diagram. Okay, the trace of this can be defined, trace of this can be defined, trace of this can be defined, right? These are endomorphisms. Okay, this is commutative diagram. What the exercise says is trace of the center one G is equal to trace of H plus minus F. Okay, so look out for vector spaces, prove that for vector spaces, okay, linear algebra, and proof for general case is exactly the same because you are doing matrix theory here. Okay, that is the solution for exercise, but you can write down the details. Next, let us take C, a graded module of finite type. Having done for short exercise sequence, you want to go for general length. Graded module of finite type. For any chain map F from C to C dot, C dot to C dot, same self map, okay? Define the left shade number, LF, as alternate sum of the traces. Okay, this is only chain complex. Here it was exact sequence, then this is alternate sum is zero here. Okay, further assume that C dot is a chain complex. This is for graded module, you can define, but C is not a chain complex and F is a chain map. If F star is induced on the homology, okay, suppose it's induced map, then the claim is LF star is equal to LF. Exactly same as Euler characteristics of H star is the same thing as Euler characteristics of C star. From a chain complex level to the homology level, you can come. Okay. So try out these exercises. If you don't get it, we'll there to help. This is just straightforward exercise. Having done it for chain complexes, this is not a difficult thing. Okay. So thank you. We will stop here. Next time we are going to introduce the most serious part of this one, namely the construction of singular homology groups. Thank you.